So we have seen how to express orders of magnitude using this big O notation. So before we get into some actual algorithms, let us look at some examples of how we would look at very simple pieces of code and try to estimate the complexity of the code. So typically there will be two types of code that we look at. Either it will be an iterative program where we run some loops, perhaps nested loops, or it will be a recursive program where the function calls itself. So let's start with some examples of iterative programs. So here is a very simple program that we all know, which is how to find the maximum in a list, right? So what we do is we start by assuming that the beginning of the list, the first element, is the maximum. And then we scan through all the elements, and wherever we find a value which is bigger than the current maximum, we update it to that value, right? So in one scan of the list, we just keep track of the maximum value that we see. So the complexity of this is very easy to estimate. So first of all, we have to calculate what is the input size. So a natural notion of input size for this is the length of the list, because obviously if we have to find the maximum in a longer list, it will take more time. And so it's reasonable to say that the input list size or the input list length is the parameter of interest. Now this is a single loop, right? So there is a for which goes through all the elements in the list, and it's going to always scan all the elements because we have no particular information about this list. We don't know whether the maximum value occurs in the beginning or in the middle or the end. So this is an example of a function that will always run that loop n times, where n is the size of the input list. So this has worst case order n, but it's also in some sense every case order n. Now let's look at a slightly more complicated question. We have a list of elements which is in no particular order, and we want to find out if the list has two duplicate elements, that is at least two elements which are the same. So for this we run a nested loop, right? So what we do is we scan through every element. So we have this whole list. So when we are looking at element Li, right, we compare this to everything to the right of I, right? So we have I plus 1 up to n minus 1. So that's the nested loop. So for every I from 0 to n minus 1, for every j from I to n minus 1, so maybe this should be I plus 1, from I plus 1 to n minus 1, we check whether Li is equal to Lj. If we ever find an Li equal to Lj, we will return false. If we find no Li is equal to Lj, then we would return true. So this now is a nested loop, right? So there is an outer loop which runs n times, and there is an inner loop which runs the first time it will run n minus 1 times, because it will run from 1, if the outer loop is at 0, it will run from 1 to n minus 1. If the outer loop is at 1, it will run from 2 to n minus 1, and so on. So it's going to run, the inner loop is going to run n minus 1 times the first time, then n minus 2 times the second time, and so on. And finally, the last time is going to run once, and then effectively there is going to be a zeroth thing which we will not worry about. So if you add up this, then this turns out to be n into n minus 1 by 2. Right? So we saw last time that n into n minus 1 by 2, we just discard the lower powers of n. So this is n squared by 2 minus n by 2. So we get rid of this and we get rid of the constants, and we can declare that this particular nested loop has worst case complexity order n squared. Now when is it going to reach the worst case? It's going to reach the worst case if it is finally going to return true. That is, it has to scan through every pair and decide that no pair is the same. So there could be much better situations, right? So there could be situations where the very first element L0 is equal to L1. Then right at the beginning of this nested loop, we will find that it is false and return. So there could be good situations, there could be bad situations, but as we said, we are looking at the worst case situation, and the worst case situation here is one where there are no duplicates and it's going to take time order n squared. Let's look at a more computational example. So let's look at the problem of matrix multiplication. So if you remember matrix multiplication, we take two matrices which are of compatible size, and then we have to multiply them to produce an element here. So if this element here is in row I and column j, then we take row I in this matrix, we take column j in this matrix, right? And we multiply pairwise every element aik with ak with bkj. So that's how matrix multiplication happens. So in particular, if this has m times n, that is m rows and n columns, and this has n rows and p columns, then the output is going to have m rows and p columns, right? So the input matrices have to have this compatibility, the number of columns of the first matrix must be equal to the number of rows of the second matrix, and the final output matrix will have the same number of rows as the first matrix and the same number of columns as the second matrix. So we will now use a very simple representation of matrices. So we will take a matrix like this and represent each row as a list. So the matrix as a whole is a list of lists. So each row is the list, each row is one list. So 1, 2, 3 is the first list. The second row, 4, 5, 6, second list, and the whole matrix is a list of these rows. So now, if you look at the code, what we have to do is first extract M, N, and P. So we are going to assume that A and B can be multiplied. So the number of rows in A, which is the number of elements at the top level of the list, is M. The number of columns in A is equal to the number of rows in B. So we can take the number of rows in B as N. And the number of columns in B is the number of entries in the first element of B, because any of these rows has an equal number of entries. So we can just pick the first one. So B0 will be the first row of B, and the number of entries in that, the length of that, will be P. So we, having got M, N, and P, we have to set up the output to be a list of M rows with P columns. So this is P0s, right? 0 for I in range P will set up a list of P zeros, and then we take M of them. So we get M rows of P zeros. So this is our initial output matrix, and now we do this update rule, right? So we take each, for each Cij, we run K over all N, and we take Aik times Bkj and add it to the current value of Cij. So we go over the number of rows in A and the number of columns in B. So this now is three nested loops. So this is going to take M iterations, this is going to take N iterations, and this is going to take, sorry, this is going to take P iterations, and this is going to take N iterations, right? So M times N times P. So the number of rows in A times the number of columns in B times the number of columns in A, which is the same as the number of rows in B. So we're going to take M times N times P. And if we are actually multiplying square matrices, that is, M is equal to N is equal to P, then this is going to be N times N times N, or N cube, right? So here we see a natural example of a problem which is actually higher than N squared. So far we saw nested loops with N squared. Now here is a problem which is actually in N cubed. At the other end of the spectrum, supposing we want to find out the number of bits or number of binary digits in the binary representation of N. So the usual way we do this is we keep dividing by 2 and we get each bit as we go along. So we can just keep a counter, initialize it to 1, and we just want to see how many times we can divide by 2 till we reach 1, right? So we keep incrementing every time we divide by 2 and we stay above 1, and finally we return this count, right? So this is what we said before when we looked at this binary search and so on, you know, when we were halving the interval, the number of times it takes to halve n down to 1 is basically log n. So this is going to take order log n steps. So for a list type of algorithm where the input is of size n, a function which takes order of log n would be considered very efficient. But we said that for number theoretic problems like this, we should not count n, the number n itself, as the input size. We should rather look at how much space it takes to write down n, which is roughly the number of digits in n. So we are saying really that the number of digits in n is proportional to log of n, and the output is taking time log n to compute. So this is actually a linear function, even though it looks like it's taking log n time. Log n itself is the size of the input, and that's something you have to keep track. Now one thing you should realize is that we might be writing it in decimal and taking it out in binary. So if you say log 10 of n and log 2 of n, you might ask, what is the connection between these two? Well, it's not difficult to see that these are connected by a constant factor. So if it's log anything of n to any base, it's order of log any other base to the n, right? So this is also log of n. So the input is, say, in base 10, so the size is the number of digits written in decimal. The output is logarithmic to the base 2, but they are both of the same order of magnitude. So as a final example, let's look at a very famous problem, which is like a puzzle. So you're supposed to take these disks, which are of different diameter and are arranged in decreasing order of size, and you're supposed to transfer them from one peg to another peg. But the constraint is that you're never allowed to put a bigger peg on top of the smaller peg. So supposing you move the smallest one here, then you cannot put this next biggest one on top of it. So you have to move the next biggest one to the other one, right? So now the question is, how are you going to transfer these n pegs from A to B? So you are given a third peg. So since you are given a third peg, in this situation what you can do is, supposing this is the smallest peg, this is the next biggest peg, now you can move this here and create a pile of 2 on that peg, for example. So this is how you can use the third peg in order to make space to move things around. So there is a very well-known recursive solution to this, and that says that, okay, I have these n pegs. Now, if I keep this peg at the bottom, right, this largest peg at the bottom, then anything can sit on top of it because it's the largest disk at the bottom. Anything can sit on top of it. So I can as well assume that this disk never moves. So now I take these n minus 1 pegs which are above and I transfer them to the third one. Now this is a smaller problem, and effectively I have all 3 pegs at my disposal because I don't have to use this one. When it gets to the bottom, I can just put anything on top of it. So having done this, now I have moved these n minus 1 things here, right? Now I can move this biggest one to the peg that I wanted to be. And now I can again solve the same problem, recursively move these n minus 1 things here, right? So I can move n minus 1 pegs from A to C, which was supposed to be the temporary peg, thinking of B as my intermediate peg. So I don't use B as my final peg. Then I move my biggest disk to the final peg, and then I can now again use the original thing A as the intermediate thing and move everything back from C to B. So I have moved n minus 1 things from A to C, one disk from A to B, and n minus disk from C to B. So when I have a recursive solution like this, then the best way to express the complexity is to think of it as a recursive formulation or a recurrence. So let me say that the number of moves m for an input of size n, if I have to move n disks, is m of n, right? It's a function of n. So if I have only one disk to move, I can always move it, right? I mean, so one disk means I start with 3 pegs and only one disk. Then I can move it in one move. I don't have any constraints. So m of 1 is 1. On the other hand, if I have more than one disk, then I have to obey this recursive solution. So what I do is I first move, this is from A to C. I move n minus 1 disk from A to C, then I move this one disk from A to B, and then I move n minus 1 disk back from C to B, right? So I have to solve this n minus 1 problem twice, and in between I have to move one disk. So if I combine this and this, which are the same, I get 2 times m minus 1 plus 1. So this gives me a kind of recursive dependence of m of n on m of n minus 1. And the usual way to solve this is to expand or unwind the recurrence by substituting. So I start with m of n being 2 times m minus 1, n minus m of n minus 1 plus 1. And now I can do the same thing to, I don't know what m of n minus 1 is, but I can apply the same formula to that. So I get 2 times m of n minus 2 plus 1. So this comes from expanding this, right? So what is inside this bracket? And then I have this outer 2 and I have this plus 1. So if I expand this out again and kind of regroup, this 2 times 2 becomes 2 squared. This 2 times 1 plus 1 is here, and I have, of course, m times n minus, m of n minus 2, right? So this is a kind of cleaned up version of this one step expansion. So now what do? I expand this again, right? I will get something in terms of m of n minus 3. So I'll get 2 times m of n minus 3 plus 1, and again, if I combine and clean up, I will get 2 squared times 2 is 2 cubed, times m of n minus 1, n minus 3, and then I'll get 2 squared times 1, 4, and I already have a 2 and I have a 1. So I have 4 plus 2 plus 1, and if you read this carefully, it's actually 2 squared plus 2 to the 1 plus 2 to the 0, right? So each time I will get a higher power of 2. So next time I will get plus 2 to the 3, right? And if you know this, or you should check this, 1 plus 2 plus 4 is 7, which is 8 minus 1. If I add 8 to that, I get 15, which is 16 minus 1. So if I add up the powers of 2 up to n, I get 2 to the power n plus 1 minus 1, right? So I should use that fact to say that if I expand this k times, this 2 to the 3 will become 2 to the k, this n minus 3 will become n minus k, and this summation will be 2 to the power k minus 1, because I would have 2 to the 0 plus 2 to the 1 up to 2 to the k minus 1. So, this becomes a general form after k steps of substituting this recurrence, and eventually when I reach 1, right, I will have 2, if I do this n minus 1 times, I will have n minus 1, which is equal to 1, right. So, after n minus 1 steps, if I take k to be n minus 1, then I will get m of 1, and this k is again n minus 1, right. So, I have 2 to the n minus 1 times m of 1. Plus 2 to the n minus 1 minus 1. But what is m of 1? Well, m of 1 is just 1, right? M of 1 was known to be 1. So, this is just 2 to the n minus 1 plus 2 to the n minus 1 minus 1, right? So, it is this plus this minus 1, which is 2 times this is 2 to the n minus 1. So, essentially, I have now by kind of laboriously substituting and coming down to the base case, I have argued that this Tower of Hanoi solution actually takes exponential time. So, if I give you n disks, it is going to take you 2 to the power of n minus 1 moves to execute that recursive solution in order to transfer all the disks. Right? So, to summarize, what we have seen is that if we are looking at iterative programs with loops, then what we really need to understand is how many times the loops execute. If there are no loops, then it is just a straight line of code, it is going to take a constant amount of steps. So, any interesting program will have a loop which will depend on the input, right. We will run through this loop. If it is a for loop, it is very easy to calculate because we know exactly how many times a loop is going to execute. If it is a while loop, then we have to be a little bit more careful to calculate how many times it will take for the while to become 1, right. So, this is something that we saw, for instance, when we looked at that number of digits thing, right. So, here we had a while loop, right. So, when we have a while loop, then we cannot tell a priori that it is going to take n steps, right. So, we have to figure out how long it is going to take for that condition to become false and the loop to terminate. So, if we have an iterative program, we are basically looking at the loops. If we have a recursive program, then we have to understand the recurrence. So, we have to say how the time complexity for the full input depends on the recursive or the inductive parts into which you are breaking it up, and then we have to solve this recurrence. So, we typically solve the recurrence like we saw here by expanding out the recurrence till you come out to the base case where you can substitute in a concrete value. And in all this, we have to be very clear about counting basic operations correctly. So, we said that this is a somewhat flexible notion and we will be not too worried about this, but you have to make sure that you are not, for instance, hiding a function call. If you are calling a function inside a loop, then you have to make sure that you can estimate the cost of that function. It may not be just one simple basic step.